Good evening, everybody. I'm going to present some work I've done recently and over the last years on and off. The topic is about a small hardware board which allows to drive microwave circuits which are based on a so-called YIG technology. The agenda will be that we are going to really very brief look into what is the YIG material, what applications and examples are possible. Then we will cover the requirements which I've had at the beginning of this project. If time permits, we will dig deeper into the circuit and layout, or if there are more interest, then we can do it at the end after the talk. We will close with an outlook and the discussion, which will be not recorded. So what is the YIG? It's think of it as a crystal. It is very similar to what silicon crystals are. They are also manufactured by growing them into high temperature. So they basically consist, if you look here, of yttrium, iron, and iron oxide. And you can see that on the picture, they are basically black to us, but essentially they are transparent over 600 nanometers of wavelength. And the most important property for us in our case is that they are very much like ferrites, resonant at microwave frequencies. And this resonance frequency is determined by a magnetic current, which basically cuts through the crystal. And the strength of this field basically adjusts the resonance frequency over a very high bandwidth, which we will see later. And the other very important property is that because of this resonance, the components which are built from this YIG material have very high Q or low loss at microwave frequencies. And essentially, this means in practical terms that if you are going to build a filter, then the attenuation is very good. And also, if you, for example, build an oscillator, the phase noise of this oscillator is also really, it doesn't have to hide itself from other circuits or microwave oscillators. So the history behind this material is really reaching in the middle of the last century, and you have to think in the context of the Cold War, because I mean the 60s is what it was, where a lot of advancement in semiconductors, in materials which we are still using today, like the transistor, have happened. And if you think about how much money was invested back then into, for example, military research, like radar, phased array antennas, all this technology which is starting to get into our homes, like, for example, the Starlink with phased array antennas, was essentially developed in the 60s, 70s, at least the theoretical foundation for this technology. And so was the case with this material, where many variants and mixtures, so to say, were developed in order to reach the properties required, because the materials simply did not exist before and had to be developed. And if you see that this material is quite old, it is not used often in modern instruments because of the reason we are going to cover in this presentation. But they are still very interesting for experimenting because there are a lot of older test gear which is available on eBay in parts. So you don't have to buy an entire signal analyzer or signal generator. You can buy parts relatively cheap. The good or most important point for experimentation is that they are connectorized and not very highly integrated. Back then, the instruments were not on a single PCB, but were interconnected by coaxial cables. So it is relatively easy to interface and figure out how they work, and not like modern instruments where everything is contained on a single PCB and highly integrated between layers, maybe. So the third property is that I've said already, it is tuned by a magnetic field, which is then induced by a voltage or DC current. And so just an example, for you can reach a very broad tuning range. In here, I have named 2 to 10 gigahertz. So the first application of YIG technology are filters, which can be used in, for example, receivers or as post filters in signal generators. And you can think of it that this YIG filter is placed in the center of a coil, and if you zoom into it, it consists of two perpendicular coils, which are normally, the coupling between those coils is not very good. But if you enable the magnetic field, the resonance frequency of this YIG sphere shifts into the frequency of your interest, and then the field couples from one coil into the YIG sphere, and because of the resonance, it there's like a field produced by the YIG sphere, and this couples into the other coil, and therefore you can pass a signal from one coil to the other if the frequency matches, or in the other direction if the tuning current is matching your frequency. For a band stop frequency rejection filter, the alignment is or the structure is a bit different. There you go directly from the input to the output via conductive line, but there the YIG spheres are, it's maybe not very scientific description, but you can think of it like a series resonance circuit. They basically suck out the energy from this coil, and it's all contained inside the field of this YIG sphere. So when signal passes through here, it gets attenuated, and it passes here, so it gets attenuated even more. And so you can see here that you can chain such YIG spheres to, for example, achieve a higher attenuation. This is an image for real filter. So here's microquarks coupling into one YIG sphere, then going to the second, the third, and to the fourth YIG, coupling out. And the YIG spheres, they are, you can see, mounted inside those coils on a usually a very good thermally conductive material. Usually it's a beryllium because of its conductive or thermal conductive properties, because the YIG sphere operates at its best at a specific temperature. Therefore, what is not in the picture, usually they are heated to a specific constant temperature, and the beryllium rod conducts the temperature from the heater, or maybe it's even the heater is based on like basically on the underneath of this ground material, but then the ground material is being heated and the beryllium rods are conducting the heat to the Higgs spheres to stabilize them thermally. So when we have such a filter, you connect them and then there's a big surprise, you don't see anything. And when you start increasing the current, you see, from 50 milliampere, there's something going on. If you increase it even further, then you see, there's definitely some bandpass-like shape, but still the attenuation is really high. It's like over 30 dB. And 400 milliampere, it's still minus 60 dB of attenuation. If you even more increase the tuning current through the coil, the field gets even stronger. And here from approximately to 120 milliampere, you get somewhat usable attenuation in passband of about minus 6 dB. And if you increase it even more, then you get minus 4 dB of attenuation in passband. If you zoom into passband, this is exemplary for this particular filter. You get a bandwidth of about, usually it's specified at minus 3 dB, but if you want to use maybe with digital signals, you probably don't want to go into this roll-off, then you probably can use maybe, like 30 megahertz or so to stay in this flat area. But this is to give you an example and a feeling of what is the filter. But you see here also one of the main disadvantages from modern times. You get a really nice filter because, the attenuation is here in lower band, it's over 90 dB. And here something like 70 dB of attenuation. But the bandwidth is, it's still wide, but it's not wide enough for modern signals like 3G, 4G, 5G, or maybe, 3G is probably good enough, but still, 4G and 5G signals are not, will not be, just the technology would not match the modern signals. And it's one of the reasons because they are not used. They are really good filters, but still, you cannot get like a bandwidth of maybe 500 megahertz or 200 megahertz. If you measure them for higher frequencies, so basically increase the current from 100 milliamps to 500 milliamps, you get a frequency course. You see that it comes out at about 14 gigahertz. From that, you can calculate the slope of this basically the tuning sensitivity of this filter. And you see also from the measured points, I've put a trend line, and you see they are really linear. So this is a very important property of a Higgs based microwave circuit, that it's really predictable. But there are still non-linearities. If you see that there is still a bit deviation here and deviation there. And this is also basically the frequency plot of the response. Here you see that it's basically non-usable below about 3 gigahertz, because the loss is really quite high. But starting from minus 6 dB of loss, you can probably still use it and compensate with some gain. So we can note that this filter is usable from about 100 milliamps, but in this particular case, I don't know what the specification is. And if we see that, it still works at 14 gigahertz, but if I calculate it, the tuning coil has about 20 ohms, and if it heats up, it will get higher. But at 500 milliamp, there are already 5 watt of basically lost energy. So you have to be careful. You cannot probably. They still work at higher frequencies, but you probably don't want to push it that much. So, and this is also one of the properties of these circuits or components, that because you're working with a magnetic field and you have to provide quite a lot of current to achieve also higher or wideband tuning range, they get really warm. And until they get warmed, you have to also have the X-sphere ready to be at the temperature to maintain this temperature. So it's thermally not trivial. Oops. So yeah, this is basically sums it up. And you can use the filters also for a closed loop control. This is just an example. So if the Yik filter is adjusted to another frequency than what you want to pass from the input to the output, the power gets reflected. And because of this circulator, the power, it doesn't get in this direction, but it all turns or goes down to this port, where it gets compared, produces an error signal, and the error signal tunes back the filter into position. So basically, this reflected power gets minimal. And the point, the one of the points of this talk will be at the end, will be this driver circuitry, which also consists a coarse tuning signal and a fine tuning signal, but we'll get to that. So another application is the multipliers, and multipliers are essentially mixers, or mixers are multipliers, used in signal generators, receivers, spectrum analyzers, and all sorts of microwave circuits. If you see this diagram, 12 is the input, where RF energy is being coupled into the X-sphere, which is tuned by this field or magnetic field. Then from here, you have the local oscillator coming, which also, where both frequencies, the input frequency and the local oscillator frequency, are reaching this mixer diode. From here, also through this quadruplexer, there is also a bias voltage provided, which puts the diode in the operating point of, I know, like most non-linearity. And the signals are get mixed, and then this quadplexer, it basically roots out probably different signal or something to this output. And based on the same principle, you can build a multiplier, which is essentially like harmonic generator, and built into a Yik filter. Here is an image given. This component has three ports because there is an internal switch, which switches between basically this port, this port and that port. And I have included this only to show you that basically the low frequency connectors are SMA. And this is, I think, what's called a K connector, 2.9 millimeters, I believe. So this is basically for the 26 or up to 26 gigahertz output. And the harmonics are usually generated with so-called step recovery diode. I'm going to very briefly cover this topic because I'm still learning about this. So essentially, the idea behind or the properties of this step recovery diode is that it is able to take electrons, to charge electrons, and then at some point in a very narrow pulse to discharge them. So you can see this. I've linked a couple of links. You can take a look where with some stimulus frequency, which is in the gigahertz range, for example, here's this 500 megahertz. But in our case, it can be some gigahertz. So essentially, this frequency pushes electrons into this diode until it's charged, And then it starts to discharge itself in a very narrow pulse. And this narrow pulse, it produces a lot of harmonics. And if you now remember or recall this frequency response plot of the Yeag filter, you will filter out one of these harmonics. And if you adjust the input frequency, then also the harmonics move. So if you increase the frequency, then the harmonic basically, so this harmonic will basically wander towards higher frequencies if you increase the input frequency, but also will do the other, but they are filtered out by the Yeag filter. So to give you an example, this is also a multiplier. It consists of, in this case, it has also a switch, built in for a low band path. And if you see to basically reach from the low band input to your output, you don't have to do anything, basically the same connection. But in the case where you want to multiply signal or pass the high band, you have to close this pin switch. So basically this signal cannot pass, it will be shortened through this capacitor. So basically this is like grounded. And then you provide a signal from here, which is then has two operating modes. In one mode, where you forward bias this step recover diode, basically in this direction. So this is the positive potential, here will be negative voltage. This works as a pin diode, basically like this one. So in the first band, or in the first mode, the signal can pass right through it without multiplication, because the diode, the step recover diode, is biased in forward direction. And then you adjust the current so that it is tuned from 2 to 3 to 7 gigahertz, so it can couple from this coil and reach the output. And in the second operation mode, you operate the step recovery diode in the inverse direction, which is it then begins to charge the current from the source waveform, produces harmonics, and then you tune or increase the field and tune above 7 gigahertz to filter out the harmonic you are interested in. And by such means, you can produce basically 20 gigahertz from 5 gigahertz, for example. And this is how it looks. So here's the low band input, this is the high band input, and there is the output. On top is a small PCB with some temperature sensing. I won't cover this with high big amount of time, but it basically is temperature sensing for the thermistor, which is built into this Yeag multiplier. There's also bias voltage for the step recovery diode, and connection to the heater. So when you connect this to 4 gigahertz, and here I want to point out that the power I was working with was 26 dBm, but given the cable losses, I have an isolator also in series. I think it was more like 24 to 25 dBm. And this is already over 300 milliwatts into this multiplier, which is really high. And at the output in this first operating mode, where basically you just use the pass band, basically this signal, you get 13 dBm out. So there's quite a lot of loss involved in this multiplier. There are also harmonics, and I've also played with the step recovery diode biasing. You can get them basically 10 dB lower if you adjust the bias correctly. So if you then select the second harmonic of this input, and I was operating without heater, just for the information. So you get about 9 dBm at 4 times multiplication, you get almost 12 dBm. And here at 20 gigahertz, you see that the magnitude is already, yeah, drastically lowered. So basically from 12 to basically 2 dBm. And you can still push it to 24 gigahertz, but then the power drops quite significantly. But still, it's usable. I mean, you could amplify it if you have amplifier for 24 gigahertz. And feed into water circuit. So, and again, if you plot the response, the frequency response, you see it's really linear. The responses or the tuning sensitivity is 15 milliampere per gigahertz. And here's basically the step recovery diode voltage in below 7 gigahertz. You operate it into in the forward direction, and over 7 gigahertz, you enable the multiplication mode by feeding it into or biasing it into a reverse direction. Here the phase noise, and just for comparison, so basically this is the fundamental from the signal generator. You see it's not very clean, and at 20 gigahertz it gets cleaner, but also the noise floor raises. So if you just see that at 10 gigahertz, 4 gigahertz, 10 kilohertz offset at 4 gigahertz, you had minus 96 dB relatively to carrier per hertz of noise. You get, let's see, over, basically 11 dB or so of, worse noise. So you can multiply signal, but also it gets, that noise gets multiplied. So it's, you have to trade off. And here's also a summary. So you can use it from 2 to 6 gigahertz. Also in the below 2 to 6 gigahertz, if you switch to the low band, which you can maybe provide signal from by other means, by PLL or mixing signals together. The spec is 20 gigahertz, but you can push it. I have used it to 26 with very low power then, or relatively low power or output power. But I mean, 400 milliamp, it's already then probably would overheat. So you should not use it over spec. And it only gets worse so with time. And if you think that basically for, I know, like maybe 30 years ago, this multiplier was using a signal generator, which was also a swept generator. So then they, I know, like maybe in 2 hertz or maybe even faster, they are able to sweep the entire range. And this becomes very difficult to do because there are small non-linearities in the response, even if it basically looks linear here, but you can zoom it and you can measure it with more detail. You will see small non-linearities which you have to account for or compensate for. And there is also hysteresis. And this comes from basically, if you imagine you sweep this multiplier with a sawtooth-like signal, which is going from 0 to maybe 10 volt. And when you reach 10 volt, you have to jump all the way down to 0 volt. But the field in the electromagnet is still there. When you switch off the voltage, the magnetic field begins to collapse, but there is still basic current flowing, and the field is still there, even though you want to be at basically zero field. And so there comes a delay, and this is relatively hard to compensate for. And back then, they used obviously analog circuits. That's why old test measurement gear is very heavy and has a lot of analog circuitry. It's basically to deal with all sorts of drift, non-linearities, and hysteresis effects. So the third application are oscillators, and I mean, you can imagine it's used basically everywhere in receivers, signal generators. And here the X-sphere is used in a feedback loop of an amplifier to produce a tunable oscillator. And also here, as I've said at the beginning, the high Q or the low loss of the X-sphere are used in the favor to produce clean signal noise-wise. The Yik oscillators use most likely dual supply. I'm not sure why, but it's probably has something to do with the transistors or circuitry they use. And some circuits or models of the Yik oscillators have a permanent magnet to basically center them around the middle of the frequency span. And then the adjustment of the frequency is done by a bidirectional current. So basically, if you, for example, increase the current, the center frequency increases. And if you reverse the current but still increase it, but in the other polarity, basically in the other direction with other polarity, the frequency decreases. And then you can basically half the current required to tune the same coverage or frequency band. So example for oscillator, these are the properties of basically tuning coil 10 ohms, current required to power them. And if you want to start to figure out where they start to work, then you just increase the current and you see oscillation starting at around 100 milliampere. And if I increase the current and you see, okay, well, so at some point there are even more harmonics produced than before. And then at about 470 milliampere, you get 9.4 or 9.5 gigahertz almost, which reaches until almost 9.9 gigahertz, where oscillation ceases. So if you just push the current and the oscillator just stops working. And you see at the power, it just way below the normal. And here, I mean, you have to account the 10 dBm attenuation. So it's basically over at almost 14 dB or so, or dBm, sorry. And again, if you plot it, then you see, okay, I can probably use it with power from, let's say, 125 milliampere or so. And here also you see non-linearities, which trend, and I mean, here I was not sure, and at the time I did not have possibility to measure high frequency, so I only measured it to 4 gigahertz, which means it's about 200 milliamps. But you still can use the trend line relatively good to estimate, yeah, well, if I'm ready to push it to 300 milliamps, and you know from the impedance or the resistance of the coil how much basically loss or power loss you will get there, so then you can estimate, okay, well, maybe I'm ready to push it to 6 or to 8. And this one is specified to 8, but you can push it to, I mean, you should not, but you still can push it to 9.5. But yeah, that's the same problem as the other examples we have seen. So this one has harmonics clearly, so they probably has to be filtered out if it's important for your application. And if you want to do open loop sweeping, then this is the same with the multiplier. There are drift, temperature drift due to heating up, cooling down. If you change the sweeping range, then it begins again to drift because your basically average current changes if you sweep. Non-linearities, hysteresis. But if you use in a closed loop control with a PLL, then it's just not a problem anymore. And this is where we slowly get to the driver. This is another example, but I'm going to skip it. It's basically just, you can take a look if you are interested, just to have another idea of what basically what I'm trying to figure out here is what is the starting current for a YIG and what is the end current for a YIG, so I am able to derive the requirements for the controller board. So this is the beginning of the Osmocom Yang. For the lack of better name, it got this one. So why another YIG driver? If you just look for YIG, I mean, it's an old technology, so the drivers, there's some technical work and documentation, some papers about YIG driver design. But I mean, obviously, it comes down to what suits me and what is missing from there. And there are some projects you can find on Google. I have linked a couple of them at the end of the presentation if you are interested. But I have not found complete design files which I could start, maybe modify. And this was basically the idea to start working on this. And because my collection of YIG components has grown and started with one, then I have two when I have started on this project, and then finally it got to three with this multiplier. So then the doing actually a small PCB was it was quite interesting thing to do. And when we come to the requirements, I wanted to make it customizable, so they would fit basically the most of the parts you can find. I did a bit of research there. So included optional parts in the circuit, some components you can change or populate, which you normally would not need to populate. Then some switchable bandwidth, but we will come to this when we cover the circuit part. The offset from my experiments determined to about 50 to 500 milliamps with changeable scope, basically the gain of this circuit. I mean, you have seen that probably 500 milliamps is the higher end you want to stress the YIG components with. So this is what I settled for. But I mean, the circuit would probably be able to drive even more. But I limited myself only to positive currents to keep the circuit easy or small, without having to support these permanent magnet components, which need a bipolar driver circuit. Also limited frequency modulation coil. This is, I forgot to cover this. So often the YIG oscillators are also include frequency modulation coil. It's a smaller coil than the main tuning coil. It has a lower impedance, and it's basically used to frequency modulate this or to connect to a frequency control loop. So yeah, therefore I needed a second channel for this FM coil. I wanted to have an onboard DAC if I use this PCB to just control the filter. So then I could digitally interface it to a microcontroller. I would cover filter, multiply, and mixer if I would ever need this. And it was a conscious decision to not include a PLL, because this also very much depends on the application, on the components you can get, the frequency range. If you want to design a PLL, then you have to know the loop bandwidth, the components you need to achieve this bandwidth, the filter structure you want to use. So it was just too many flexibility or too much flexibility to cover in this one go. So therefore, I decided to just keep it out and start with a small part of the driver. And these are the two other points. Might require a quality substrate if you're working with higher frequencies, like, I don't know, 20 GHz or so. But it probably also starts from maybe 2 gigahertz. You see the disadvantages properties of FR4, for example. And another point is to have this driver in a small PCB is to be able, when you build a device or put it everything into a case, to be able to thermally manage the heat better. So it will allow me to mount the parts that are getting hot, like the driver transistor or the EEG itself, somewhere where a fan is available, or at the backside of the instrument where a heat sink is available or something like that, and to keep the radio frequency circuit at another place where this is then required, and connect both with a coaxial cable. Then again, small form factor, two layer, nothing fancy. And finally, KiCad design, which then would be able to be modified by myself and others in the future. I did some simulation. I'm going to skip this. It's not very exciting. I just want to point out that I tried a couple of things. And for the FM driver, is basically if you use the FM channel and interface it to a PLL, you usually will be operating around zero because the PLL will normally close the loop. And you will use the main tuning coil to preset somewhere where you have a rough idea where you want to be with the PLL. And then the PLL will basically try to keep somewhere around this area, or let's say around center. So it's very important to not have distortion around center. So I tried this circuit. This did not really look that promising. So I've tried another one, and then another one, and basically settled with the middle one, because if you want to have the third one, you just bypass the diodes, and then it's basically the same, but without diodes. But here you also see this output of the amplifier is also contributing to the common output. And in the second, it's just basically terminated into this one, and the transistors are alone contributing to the current output. So, but I mean, still have taken both designs into consideration, so you can populate both. Obviously, you have to bridge the diodes, and in this, there's a small bridge to solder. So I think I'm going to switch to KiCad because it's easier to show there. This is the interface. And if you recall, EEG filter doesn't need any power supply. It only needs a heater connection and the tuning coil. So I tried to address this, and the EEG multiplier has some power supply for the temperature sensing. Then the EEG oscillator, it has positive and negative supply voltage. It has a frequency modulation coil and a tuning coil. And there you see this is the EEG connector. We have the coils, you have the EEG power supply, and you have the heater. The heater is directly connected, and everything, I did not want to connect on this PCB, but everything is basically wired out on the main power supply connector. So if you want, you can either bridge them or connect the wires outside of this PCB, even if you use the same voltages. But I wanted to have the flexibility, not to narrowing down the possibility of interconnect here. A lot of bypass filtering, just to be on the safe side. You probably don't need to, or you can decide on your own whether or not this is really necessary for you. You can populate shunt or some resistors to lower the heater voltage, for example, if you need to connect a 24 volt heater, but you have like plus and minus 15 volts power supply. You can just connect the wires to the same potential as the input for this whole circuitry, and then just some voltages being dropped here at these resistors. in parallel with the Yuke tuning coil, there are optional damping resistors, some decoupling, as a protection diodes for the transistor down there, and you can bridge the switch here with the relay, which then connects those capacitors in parallel with the coil, which then essentially will reduce the bandwidth of the resulting circuit. So basically, it's like an LC resonant circuit, which frequency then gets really low, or at least much lower than the original, with it, only the coil connected. This is potentially interesting if you operate like a sweeping or a constant wave signal generator. Then you need another bandwidth when you're sweeping than with the constant wave, a fixed frequency. Then if you tune the fixed frequency, you can just electronically close this relay, and then the oscillator should get a lower sensitivity when it comes to noise. So you can get a more noise-free frequency. I'm sorry. So the main e-coil is driven by this voltage to current converter. Here is the shunt resistor, also some optional ones on the bottom of the PCB if you want to use them. There are also, again, some optional components which you can play with. There is also here a small jumper which you can break, and then you could, which is normally ground potential, you could provide a negative voltage from here. But this is only a circuit option, you don't miss this. Here again, just less in case with this relay and Yuke coil, tuning coil in the Yuke, you have the ability to connect a capacitor at the input of this voltage to current converter to narrow down the bandwidth. So again, for like steady state operation, I have an optional inversion stage because I used double op amps. I have this one spare, so in case you want to basically invert the operating direction, you can use this, or otherwise you just don't populate this one. And at the beginning of the circuit, you have an offset and a gain adjustment. Just ignore this part for now. You have a reference, which is then basically scaled down and inverted, because we need here a negative polarity because of the operating amplifier or operational amplifier. And here with this values of resistors, you can get an offset with this potentiometer of starting from about 50 milliampere to up to, let's say 600 milliampere. And if you see the input here, you can also adjust it from the sensitivity, from this given sensitivity. So basically, if you want to adjust or to control the circuit with higher voltage than the VREF, which is basically designed for. So the idea is, if you provide this output reference to some circuit, maybe a DAC or other or PLL, you can put the error output of the PLL to here. And if it has another amplitude, maybe even higher than the 4 volts, then you can scale it down or scale it up, the sensitivity. And on the bottom, there is a frequency modulation part, which you can bridge over to from the main tuning input, but only AC coupled. So basically, if you want to try to tune by high amount, the voltage spikes are getting coupled to this capacitor and contribute also to the tuning field into the FM modulation coil, but if you don't populate this, which is the default, you can control the frequency modulation coil again with a scaling, with a scaling potentiometer, the sensitivity. A low pass, not very interesting, but just to filter out noise. And here is also just similar with the main tuning coil circuit to decrease the bandwidth or the tuning sensitivity of the whole circuit. But this is also optional, so you can just populate here 0 ohms and then you're fine if you don't need this. And this is the circuit. So here again, you can recognize the diode and also this bridge. So essentially, if you want, you don't even have to populate the transistors. If it's the current this operation amplifier is providing is sufficient for you, then you just populate this one, don't populate the transistors, and then you're fine. This is basically the circuits. This is the PCB. So I've started it some time ago, as you can see. And yeah, now this is how it looks. And this is basically the test setup where I provide bipolar power supply for the circuit. The positive is also going to the YIG. The negative is also going to the YIG. I have not wired the power, the heater, and I can tune it through this through this input here, and this is the frequency modulation input, because you see this bridge capacitor is not populated. And there is the power transistor MOSFET, and this is the shunt with some decoupling capacitors. So if you want to use it, I think what comes to mind is if you are interested in maybe signal generation, then it probably would be interesting to use a modern PLL, which also has some harmonics at its output, and then interface to a filter and track the filter by controlling the DAC. Then if you have a multiplier, then you can just control the multiplier to produce higher frequencies. And if you have an oscillator, then you can build a receiver, a network analyzer, or if you have another idea, then you can use it as well, or design it, because the design files will be available. So, and what I want to do in the future is to create a PLL board to control the driver. I'm not sure yet which PLL is best, but maybe something from analog devices. So if you have designed a PLL previously, so please reach out. I will be happy to hear what you think, what has worked in the past, and I mean the frequency range will be maybe from somewhere from 2 to maybe 20 gigahertz or so. So I want to do another version which does not have the frequency modulation part, but is instead Heisite MOSFET, because I won't be going into details at this point, but in the multiplier I have, and this apparently is what I could find is doesn't happen always. The tuning coil is connected to the heater, so there is not a lot of flexibility when it comes to driver circuit. And unfortunately, because I have bought the multiplier relatively cheaply later, after it basically already has been designed and ordered, I could not adjust this and compensate for this schematic specific of this multiplier, of this particular multiplier. So I think I will create a Heisite circuit at a DAC to adjust the step recovery diode, because it has to be adjusted depending on the input frequency, on the output frequency you want to produce, in relatively high a range, so maybe basically from, I don't know, like 7 volt to maybe -3 volt or so. Then the pin diode to control this high and low pass selection, and maybe a small ADC to read back the temperature to see whether or not it has reached a stable operating point. So a couple of tips. As you have seen already, the YIG components are not operational at, from the steady state or from the beginning. You have to add some current or to induce some field, build up some magnetic field for them to begin to operate. So I would suggest to start somewhere about 50 to 100 milliamps range. You can use the linearity to your advantage. So like in my case, where I have measured it to 4 gigahertz and then could estimate, and the estimate was basically the trend line was already relatively correct. As you have seen, basically for all four examples, it's quite linear, at least when zoomed out. So yeah, protect your gear with the FM frequency modulation coil. It's like almost like 1 ohm or even below, so you could burn it quite easily if you are not paying attention with your power supply. Use a power supply with current limitation. If you want to use to find parts online, then obviously eBay, search for parts of these manufacturers. If you find specific parts which are basically interest you from HP Edgeland, you can use the Keysight Find a Part website to enter the part numbers, and then you will find a list of instruments where those parts were used. And from there, you can, if you are lucky, find schematics, service manuals to understand the pinout, the voltage ranges involved, the power supply numbers. And yeah, this is a couple of links. We will place it very likely at this path, so in a couple of days. So this is for me. Thank you. And let's thank yttrium, iron, and especially oxygen. Thank you.